chain of blocks. So whatever hash we get here, that goes into here, okay? And then the hash of this whole block goes into here. And that's how these blocks are linked. Now, later on, we'll see in a consensus algorithm called proof of work that it's a requirement that whatever block hash you get, the starting 4 bits must be zero. Okay. So that's a requirement. So if I put some value here and the starting trailing bits are not zero, then the whole chain breaks because that requirement is not fulfilled. Now I have a variable number called n1s, and I'll have to find such an n1s such that that requirement is satisfied. So finding that is called mining. Okay, so when I click on mine, you see it did that for all the blocks. Okay, because I messed with the first block, it had to go ahead and mine for all the blocks. But if I mess with this block, only this block is broken. So I'll have to go ahead and mine and find an n1s such that the trailing 4 bits are zero. Okay, so this is the condition that needs to be fulfilled. Why it needs to be fulfilled? Big to slow the network down. To slow the network down, because if this condition was not put in here, then the network traffic will just jam the Bitcoin network or Ethereum network. So this is mining here is very quick, as you can see, but in real life, the condition is far more than this. It's not 4 zeros, is like 8 zeros or something. Finding that hash is that much difficult and requires that much computation, so it takes a lot of time. So that slows the network down. That's why one transaction to actually occur on the blockchain can take anywhere from 10 minutes to 30 minutes, depending on the network traffic. So another visual demo is I have is on the Reuters, graphics.reuters.com. It's a good one. Using these graphics on my presentation would not be allowed, so I just came here and we'll just look at this, what they have given. So they're saying that blockchain is nothing but a database, okay? And a block is a bundle of records or transaction. And here we have a chain of those blocks. And a record can be any information. So yeah, they have defined the steps. A record can say, okay, a trade happened between this party and this party, and that is my record. A lot of records can come together and form a block. And now I have a new record, right? It needs to be accepted by the network. So I broadcast it to the network, it needs to be accepted, and then the record has actually happened on the blockchain. And here they are saying that this is just one of the transactions that has been added to the block. So a block can contain a lot of transactions, and a hash is calculated. Basically, the upper edge is the previous hash of the previous block. This is the hash of the latest block, and it goes on adding to the chain. So this is the hash of the previous block. The hashes match, should match. Cool. Now they are saying that hash functions, even if you take up this, you'll get this. If you take up a whole book, you still get a fixed length hash. Now, if you change one character in the whole book, you'll get a new hash. And if you get a new hash, it breaks the chain. So, for example, someone was to change something in one of the records, that will change the hash of the entire block, and that will end up breaking the blockchain. That's straight. Centralized and decentralized networks. We saw this pretty much self-evident from the diagrams. Now, here they're saying that public blockchains, anyone can join anonymously, and private blockchains have a permissioning system. Now, consensus algorithms like proof of work, proof of stake, we'll look at it in the we'll look at possible uses also in the later stages of this session. So, till now, just checking if anyone has any questions in the meeting. Okay. Now, this is an important way that transactions are stored in the blockchain, UTXO versus account balance model. So Bitcoin uses UTXO. UTXO is nothing but unspent transaction output. So any transaction has an input and an output. So an input is basically we are saying that, okay, take these many coins. And an output is saying, okay, spend these many coins. So here you can see that in transaction zero, we are taking 100,000 satoshis. That is the smaller version of Bitcoin. So Bitcoin can be divided into satoshis. So here we're taking 100,000 input and in two separate outputs. That means we are creating two separate transactions out of them. We are spending 40K and we are spending 50K. Okay, that means what this guy has left as unspent is 10K. So right now the balance of this guy is 10K and he can spend it in another output. Whoever got this 40K has spent 30K and he has 10K unspent. Whoever spent this 50K spent 40 out of it. And whoever got this 20, 10, spent 10 out of it, and so on. So whatever the output was unspent is your balance basically. So Ethereum takes another approach. It just stores using account and balance model. So account is your address and your balance is any value. So to understand how Ethereum stores account and balances, we'll have to understand a very important data structure called Merkle trees. Okay, it's just a tree in which you take these transactions at the leaf side. So on the leaves, you have any number of transactions. You take their hashes. You append those hashes and take that hash. You append these hashes and take that hash. And at the end, you get a root hash, which goes into a block. Now this block contains just the root hash, not all this information. So this is just to reduce the size of the block because a block is propagated throughout the network and we don't want the size to be a lot. So in real life scenario, a block can consist of 500 to more than like 1,000 transactions. So we take the hashes of all those transactions and we hash up from down. We collectively hash all the leaves and we hash them and at the end we get a root hash which goes into the block. So we can call it Merkle root or root hash or anything. Now if we were to change any information in one of these transactions, that would lead to a change in the Merkle root. So it's a good way to verify whether all these transactions are the same or not. If these transactions end up giving me a different Merkle root than what I expect, then that means there has been some meddling with the data. Okay. Now, here in the second picture, they're showing us that if we are only concerned with transaction three, then we don't need to have all this data either. Someone can just give me, like, if I ask a node, ask a Bitcoin node that, okay, give me the Merkle root of transaction three. And I want to verify whether transaction three happened or not. So it doesn't have to give me the rest of the 500 transactions. It can just give me, it can prune out all the other transactions and just give me transaction 3 and the hash of the other branches and hashes as we go up from here. So I can still start from here and get the same root hash. So it's still verifiable that transaction 3 actually happened in this block. So there's a Merkle tree, very important data structure. We'll look at it in the further slides also. This is how Ethereum stores accounts and balances. Now there are two blocks here. Okay, this is the first block. Just checking whether we have a question. This is the first block in which the account A has a balance of 100. Okay, and now this is the root of the tree. And this is all the unspent transactions that will give me basically 100. Now, something ends up happening, a transaction ends up happening, and in this next block, the account A has a balance of 50. So basically, the state root was pointing to this root, now it will point to a new root, which when I traverse will give me 50. Earlier, when I was traversing the account A, I was getting 100. So, to look at this in more clarity, this is an overwhelming diagram, but basically, this is the state that this diagram is representing. There are four accounts and there are four balances. So, this account has 45 Ether, this account has 1 V, which is a subdivision of Ether. Like a Bitcoin can be divided into Satoshis, Ethereum can be divided into V. This address has 1.1 and so on. So, if we start from A7, now this is the root hash. This is how we traverse an address. A7 7 D3 9 has 0.12. So A7 7 D3 9 and 7 has this much balance. So in the same tree, all the four balances are stored. If you traverse like this, you'll end up with A7 1135, 1355, and if you traverse like this, you'll end up here, and if you traverse like this, you'll end up here. So basically, all Ethereum blocks have a tree which is called world state tree, and that tree holds the accounts and balances of all the participants that are on Ethereum. So it ends up being a large tree, but basically all the blocks don't have all the value. All the blocks just have the root hash. So what is propagated throughout the network is just the root hash and not all the values that you're seeing here. Now then, who stores all these values? There are different types of participants. Full nodes only have the complete copy of the ledger. So only full nodes will have all these values of the tree, and light nodes will just have the state root. So full nodes have a complete value of the ledger. They do create new blocks and broadcast them throughout the network. And now miners. So you guys must have heard of Bitcoin mining and Ether mining and these things, right? So miners have a special job on these blockchain networks. Miners actually do what we were doing on that visual demo on the website. We were clicking mine and it was creating a new hash, right, which was satisfying a condition. So miners actually do that, but it's not that easy. It requires a lot of computation power. So they set up mining rigs, and the job of those mining rigs is just given a certain block to calculate hash such that it satisfies a following condition. So that block has thousands of transactions, and once you get that hash, you just propagate it through the network. Miners end up getting a mining reward, and that's how Bitcoin comes into existence from mining reward. So that's how Bitcoin are being created. So that's the job of a miner. A light node, as opposed to a full node, a light node does not have the complete copy of the ledger. It just has the block headers. We look at what block header is, what all goes in a block header. And light nodes are basically dependent on full nodes for verification and stuff. We'll look at simplified payment verification also. Basically, if you want to participate in a blockchain network, you have two options. You can either set up a full node and download all of the blockchain history and then start propagating new blocks or getting new blocks and verifying them. Or you can set up a light node and you can trust another full node. So if you are an untrusting participant, you would be better off setting up a full node, but that would require the full node to be running 24 hours, and it will require it to have obviously a lot of storage, because blockchains end up getting the size ends up getting a lot, and it keeps on increasing throughout time, right? So, coming finally to consensus algorithms, very important to understand what a consensus algorithm is. Basically, if I go on creating my own database, with my own transactions, and another node goes on creating its own transactions, how do we stay on the same page? How do we ensure that if account A has a certain balance on my database, account A has the same balance on another database? So for ensuring that, I have divided those consensus algorithms into two. Like public blockchains, certain consensus algorithms are more suitable for public blockchains, and certain are for private or enterprise blockchains. So proof of work, if you have heard of it, is the initial consensus algorithm that Satoshi Nakamoto came up with in that white paper. So proof of work basically, it requires a lot of computation power, and mining is involved in it. And basically, you'll have to calculate that hash which satisfies the condition. And if you have that hash, that means you can prove to the network that, okay, I have done some computation work to get this hash. And that's how I can prove to you that I am a legitimate user. So that's all you need to do, basically. And it is a race. So all the participants in the Bitcoin network or Ethereum network or any blockchain that uses this particular consensus algorithm, all the participants or miners, those are doing that job, have a race among them to calculate that hash. And as we saw in that demo, basically we have to try out different N1s values until we get that hash, and there is no other viable strategy to get that hash. So we start from one and we go up to a nonce value until we get that hash which satisfies a difficulty. So now, what's a difficulty? Basically, you know, when I said that a hash should have 8 trailing zeros or 4 trailing zeros, the actual challenge is to get the hash value below a certain target. And when you get a hash value below the certain target, it automatically has those 4 zeros. So 4 zeros are a result of it being below a certain value. So basically, a target is set, okay, this value, any hash above this particular value is invalid, and any hash below this particular value is valid. So that is the challenge of proof of work. All the miners are competing to get that hash, and whoever gets it first will broadcast it to the network, and end up getting the mining reward. In this diagram also, you can see blocks contain the transaction route, the Merkle route, and it is linked with the previous hash, and it goes on. Yeah, anyways, this is what a block contains. To look at it in more depth, this is what a block header actually contains. So of course, the version of the blockchain, the previous hash, the Merkle root, the timestamp, difficulty target, what is the target value below which your hash should be, and once what is the number that you got such that the hash of this entire block header is below the difficulty target. Cool. Any doubt till now? Simplified payment verification is another thing that I think we have already looked at. A light node has to be dependent on the full node for verifying payment. So if you make a transaction on the blockchain and you're not a full node, you'll have to look at another full node and ask it whether give me a valid block which contains my transaction. And if I get a valid block that contains my transaction, that means that transaction actually happened. So when I ask a full node that, okay, give me my transaction 3. So it will just give me the pruned Merkle tree and the root and the block header, and I can verify it. So this is SPV. Basically, the verification is you go on calculating your hash from the leaf to the root such that you get the root hash, and such that you get the hash of the entire block header to be the latest block, whatever the latest block of the chain is. So once you get that, you can be sure that, okay, your transaction actually happened. That's SPV. Proof of work was one consensus algorithm that we looked at, but you know, proof of work ends up consuming a lot of computation power. It ends up consuming a lot of electricity. So it is not practical for a private blockchain to conduct out an algorithm on such a scale, right? So we'll look at other ways to counter this, but one of the algorithms is Raft that you're looking at right now. Basically, you randomly assign a leader node. So in this network, there are 5 nodes, and in a proof of work scenario, all the nodes would be competing to get that hash that satisfies the difficulty, right? But in this one, you just end up trusting one of the nodes. Now, how is that node elected? You have random elections. Like every T amount of time, you'll have an election, and any node can stand up as or to be the leader. All the other nodes can vote yes or no. Then that leader decides what is the transaction that is getting into the chain. And then that leader ends up changing, another leader ends up getting appointed. This all happens automatically. There is no manual intervention. So it's basically based on a random number generator or something like that, because the election happens randomly. So it is more trusting because you are trusting that one leader node. But what ends up happening is it's faster, because there is no hash calculation, there is no mining and such. So it's faster in proof of work. It ends up consuming very less electricity compared to proof of work. As we'll see, proof of work, because the difficulty goes on increasing, people end up setting up mining rigs as big as warehouses, and basically the accumulation of the computing power ends up happening in with certain people only. So yeah, this is what we're talking about, disadvantages of proof of work. Anyone who has a lot of hashing power has more authority in a proof of work network. So in the Bitcoin network, if you have the biggest mining rig, then basically you can end up having the authority on paper. Like you can end up having the authority on which transactions end up getting into the network. And like people like you and me can't set up our own mining rigs because that's a lot of investment. And these miners also end up getting a lot of the mining reward also. So it's a lot like our capitalist system. Energy is wasted, no actual use to the society or anything. So that those are the disadvantages. Also, this diagram is outdated, but if you look at the concentration of mining pools, so those mining rigs are also called mining pools. People can contribute their hash computation to that mining pool and set up these big pools that basically you can rent or you can use. So, like you can see, BTC.com is a big mining pool, has 19%, and pool is 7%, 13% is unknown, like where it is coming from. So, mostly it is like individual miners or something. And if BTC.com and AntPool decide to join hands and have one and take over the Bitcoin network and have one big mining pool, then they can do that. But they'll need more than 50% of the mining power. So this is not that democratic. This is very, I don't know, capitalistic or something. So that's the major disadvantage of proof of work. As we were talking about them, the big mining pools joining hands and attacking the Bitcoin network, let's talk about several attacks that can happen on the blockchain. So these things are important to understand the nature of the blockchain because if the majority of the network participants say that the latest block hash is a certain value, then that is accepted as the truth. So a blockchain ends up running successfully only when the majority of the participants are honest. And if like 51% of the miners, if they were to collude and coordinate this attack on the chain, then they can take over the network and say that, okay, we are taking this chain in another direction. And they can say that, okay, we are transferring all the funds to our own account. And because they have the majority of the mining power, they can do that. But if you read Satoshi's white paper, he has calculated the probability of this happening is very less. This hasn't happened yet. But it's a thing worth considering. Any questions till now? Okay, there is. Okay, it's a question related to Raft. S4 is the leader node here. So the role of the leader node is to decide which transaction ends up getting into the blockchain. So if at this point, when S4 is the leader, if any transaction was to come in, S4 would be responsible to create a block out of that transaction, calculate the hash, and then all the other nodes will just accept that block. Cool. Does that answer your question? I hope it does. We looked at 51% attack or majority attack. Cool. Finney attack is another one. So we'll still look at. I wish there was a diagram here. Okay. So in this attack, if one generates a block and says that, okay, I transferred this much funds to another account, which is also owned by me, and I withhold that block and I don't broadcast it to the network yet. Now, I go and pay a merchant with my coins, and the merchant accepts that payment. Now I go and broadcast my blog to everyone. Then I end up, what ends up happening is you also have the funds that you paid with. So you paid with it also, and you still have the funds. So it's like you double spent your coins. So you use the funds for payment to a merchant, which merchant ends up accepting, and you later on broadcast a block which transfers those same funds to another account which is also held by you. So in this case, the merchant accepts zero confirmation transaction. Now, zero confirmation transaction is not to be accepted. So in general, when you pay with Bitcoin to any merchant, the merchant has to wait for at least 6 confirmations before actually accepting a transaction. What's a confirmation? Whenever you receive a payment, you'll have to look at 6 different full nodes and ask them, okay, whether this transaction actually happened or not. And if 6 of those nodes say that, okay, here's the block header and the Merkle root, and you can see that it happened, then you can be sure that it happened. So in case someone doesn't wait for those confirmations, that means there is no guarantee that that transaction actually happened. So for example, if we pay using any centralized service, Visa, MasterCard, Visa or MasterCard themselves are the only authority who can say whether transaction happened or not. If their gateway says that, okay, transaction happened, then we don't have to ask anyone else, right? But in Bitcoin, all the nodes are basically, when a transaction is happening, all the participants get that same transaction. Now, it slowly propagates throughout the network. That doesn't happen instantly, right? So it takes a lot of time. So that's when they say that, okay, a transaction to happen on the Bitcoin blockchain, it takes 10 minutes or 30 minutes or more than that, because it slowly goes on propagating through the network. But the probability that, okay, 6 random nodes have got the same transaction, that means, okay, it has spread sufficiently. So I can be sure that, okay, this transaction happened. So waiting for those confirmations is important. Replay attack is another one of those. So this can happen during the start of a chain hard fork. Now, what's a fork? So a chain can be forked, meaning the community can collectively decide, okay, we are changing up the protocol, or we are changing up something in the protocol of this blockchain. And now all the further blocks from this point will have this new protocol. So at that point, a fork happens. Okay. Which you can see here also, A and B are two forks that are happening. And A might go on and follow some other rule or protocol from this point on, and the chain might go on, and B might go on and follow some other rule or protocol. And this has happened a lot. This has happened in Bitcoin also, when they had some disputes about the size of the block, and some people said, okay, we want this size, and some people said, no, we want to increase it. And a fork happened at that point. So there are two chains right now: Bitcoin Cash, BTC, and Bitcoin, the normal Bitcoin chain. So those chains are still continuing going. Okay, so at this point, this attack is basically, you can use up your already accepted block from one fork into another fork. So that's the attack. And it's very important to understand what forks are for this. So till this point, I have just covered what a blockchain is, and just to give you a feel of, okay, what this technology actually is and what the cryptographic functions are used and what are the data structures used in this, how it can be attacked, what is the state of the chains right now. And so we are going to move on to a different topic from now. So any question till now? Cool, replay attack can be avoided using time slice or session key. It is implementable in blockchain as well. Well, I don't know what you mean by session key or time slice in this context, but basically it can be avoided by implementing some property that will be required in the new fork. So for example, it can be avoided if you decide at this point that fork A, all the blocks will need to have this particular property, and any block which doesn't have it will not accept. So fork from so blocks from fork B will not have that property because they are from an outdated fork, right? This is the chain that is continuing and this is the new version, right? So in the new version, you have to have some property or some change in the hashing method or some change in the size of the block or something that you can guarantee, okay, this is the new fork and the blocks that are coming here will be unique and can't be reused from another fork. So if you get into the details of how the forks have actually happened, they have prevented replay attack because they have implemented all, every time they have implemented some new value or some new property that will need to be in the in those forks. I hope that answers your questions. So why are we talking about blockchain anyway, right? We are developers. We want to develop something that will be useful for the industry, right? So where are they using this technology in the industry? Anywhere that you need trust and transparency. Okay. So anywhere that there are several untrusting or non-trusting participants or enterprises or organizations that need to work, but they also don't trust each other, right? And for example, organization A, B, and C are working on a shared database. And who stores that database? Who has the authority on that database? And if all have equal authority, then who stops who from making changes to that database, right? So there's where things get complicated right now. So right now, a lot of disputes happen because of this. The process is very slow. If you see in the banking sector, if you see in the healthcare sector, a lot of from one hospital to another, if the records have to be transferred, there is a lot of overhead that is there. So a blockchain can be very useful in storing a shared database or a shared ledger among these organizations. And that's where the ability to develop or write code or write programs on the blockchain comes in. So till now we were seeing that, okay, transactions are happening on the blockchain, but these transactions are just value transfers from one address to another. These transactions are just saying that, okay, I transferred one coin from this to this. But what if we could write code? Now we know that the transactions on blockchain are irreversible, final, can't be changed. If they are changed, then the whole chain will break. So similarly, if we write code on the blockchain, we know that even it can't be changed. Even it can't be meddled with. If two parties agree and write code that they agree and deploy it on the blockchain, then they can interact with it independently. And you can be sure that, okay, this is the code that we agreed upon and that's what's deployed on the blockchain. So that's the concept of development on blockchain. That's where things have become interesting. This is an illustration that I took from Corda white paper. Corda is a blockchain framework. We'll look at it later on. So they are saying that, okay, bank A and bank B want to have some shared business, okay? They want to interact, they want some logic to be shared. So earlier, things used to happen on one side, and then it used to be sent to the other side, and reconciliation used to happen. Okay. Now, this is literally taking the double amount of effort and double amount of time for doing maybe one transaction or resolving one dispute. And even then, the transaction is not final. So actions happen on one side, and then reconciliation happens on the other side. This is how things used to be, or rather still are. Another thing is, you can share the messaging and reconciliation platform. You can share the messaging platform, but still the actual business logic, the actual code would still be different. And you can share the hosting platform also. Okay. You can share a service provider, but still the actual protocol or actual business logic would be differently written for each party, and they will be interacting with it independently. So what the perception of Corda is they are saying that even the perception is shared. So the ledger platform is shared. That means the data is shared, but it is a guarantee that if you're looking at a data, that's the same data that the other party is also looking at. So this is the guarantee of the blockchain, which it provides. So if you're looking, so if you are sharing a database, it is immutable, it is final. So you have that much guarantee that it can't be meddled with. If it does, then things will end up breaking, and it will be very known that, okay, this is something fishy is happening. So this is the very zoomed out view of what Corda is trying to do.
One question I have, actually, like, if we did a transaction in blockchain and if we need to revert it, like, need to undo a transaction, can't we do it there? For example, if you do a bank transaction, need to revert the money, you can undo that transaction somehow, like.
Yeah. So you are asking whether a transaction can be reverted in a blockchain? Is there a way to do that?
Yeah, yes. Like,
so the simple answer is no. Transactions, by the very nature of the blockchain, those are irreversible. Once you make a transaction, it is like, if it's written on the blockchain, it's written on the blockchain. There is no, by nature of it, there is no way of reversing it. Now, you can make the other party refund you the money back. Obviously, that's happen. That's possible. So if you transfer from A to B certain amount, you can ask B to another create another transaction and revert the same amount back to you, and you can ask B to just broadcast that transaction to everyone. But then B can definitely say, okay, no, I'm not going to do that. Yeah, so a lot, there's a lot of times that this has happened where some funds got transferred accidentally, or someone hacked something and funds got transferred accidentally, and then those funds are just lost on Ethereum and on Bitcoin. This has happened. So yeah, that's a good question, but there is no inherent way of doing a refund on the blockchain. You have to have a central authority, right? So a central authority has to say that, okay, I'm canceling this transaction, but there is no central authority.
Thanks.
Cool. Okay. Then we were talking about uses of blockchain in real world. There are several I've listed down. We have already looked at cryptocurrency. We have already looked at banking, because in banking also transactions and record keeping is involved, so there needs to be finality and these things. Now, what's a supply chain? Even in a supply chain, things change hands from one party to another party, right? So that, there are several distrusting parties in a chain, and you need to transfer the ownership of the good from one party to another party. And which party will keep the record of what has actually happened, right? So they all need to be on a shared infrastructure or a shared platform where the record is gonna go, and which can't be changed once it has gone in. So a supply chain is a good example. We'll look at that example also further. Healthcare, patient records, medical records of a patient, when all the hospitals, if they share those records, then it will be easily available and to everyone, first of all. And second thing is, it can't be meddled with. And it can't be meddled, even if the patient gets the authority. For example, if their private key is needed to change the record, then the patient has the authority on no record. So that's a good thing that they can be possible. Voting. Now there are several voting samples out there that you can get. Okay, implementation of anonymous voting on Ethereum or implementation of anonymous voting on Corda. There is a problem of, if the voting is anonymous, then you can create multiple accounts and do bogus voting. But if the voting is identity based, then some kind of restrictions need to be put in, or some kind of list needs to be created. So it's a give and take. Some kind of voter list needs to be created by a central authority. So that's where some centralization comes in. But if you trade that for finality, then you can do voting on blockchain. Property records and another thing, it's the same as any record keeping. All these
if you consider this operation, healthcare and property records, we are maintaining some information, and if there's some like wrong information is there and you need to edit it, and it's immutable, so we cannot change it, right? So in that case, how we handle that part?
Well, you can always create a transaction, and so in this case, if you are creating a property record, multiple parties are involved, right? So there's always verification that can happen from multiple eyes, first of all. Even if something wrong ends up getting into the blockchain, there can be, like, we can code in functions to allow editing only with the agreement of certain parties. So later on, we're gonna see coding on blockchain. So we can write programs which can allow, okay, only if I get agreement from these parties, then I'm able to write another transaction which will edit this record. So those things are possible.
But you said that blockchains are immutable, transactions are immutable. So that it means that information we can edit also later, and it's not immutable then?
We are not actually editing. So when I say we are editing, I'm not editing that record. I'm going on and creating a new block.
Okay.
Right. I'm going on creating a new block, and which will have the same record, but with the new information.
Okay.
Right. So we only look at the latest block. Yeah. We don't look at the previous block. So previous block has the outdated information. Yep. So the applications are not limited to these that I have listed. Anywhere that you need. Anywhere that multiple parties are interacting with each other, and they need to trust a system and not each other, then a blockchain is a good use case. So I'm talking about like coding on blockchain. So what makes it possible? So Ethereum is a framework that first made it possible. So people were putting everything on blockchain, right? Separately, like currency on blockchain. Physical asset, ownership of physical assets on blockchain, and certain records on blockchain, like domain names on block. But the Vitalik Buterin, the creator of Ethereum, said, okay, how about we create a generalized framework for programming anything on blockchain? So he created Ethereum. Ethereum is a proof of work blockchain currently. They're going to switch to proof of stake. soon, but it's quite, until now it's quite similar to Bitcoin, but we have seen like certain differences, like how they store account and balances. But they have blocks, they have transactions, they have mining, and they have transaction hash and block hash and everything. But instead of transactions going on the block, we have bytecode going on the block. Okay, so you write your smart contract, which is basically a program, a piece of code. Okay, and it's called a contract because when you write a because a contract has the agreement of certain parties, right? So certain parties agree upon a logic and write it in a piece of code and deploy it to blockchain, and then they interact with it. So it's quite like a contract. Now you write your code in Solidity, is a programming language, and it compiles into Ethereum bytecode, EVM bytecode. And it goes on the Ethereum virtual machine and it runs on the Ethereum virtual machine. So if you are gonna be a participant of the Ethereum network, then you're gonna have to have an Ethereum node which has EVM inside it, and these EVMs are capable of executing this EVM bytecode. But this basically, those bytecode are inside the blocks. And rest of the things, like the blocks are linked via previous block hash and their signatures and everything is the same. Cool. So let's come to this. Yeah, we have discussed these points before, but a public blockchain like Bitcoin, all the transactions are visible to everyone. Like we just went on Etherscan and saw the Ethereum transactions. We can go to any Bitcoin blockchain explorer and see all the transactions that are happening right now. So the address is visible, but there is no real world identity linked to the address. We can look at those transactions. We can look at what funds are being moved from where to where. So that's like, if you desire some privacy, if you are an organization, you desire some privacy, you can't use a public blockchain for your interactions. You need an enterprise blockchain or something like that. And anyone can be a part of a public blockchain, right? And you can still be anonymous. You can have multiple identities, but in certain organization scenario, like all the use cases that we saw before, banking and hospitals and everything, you need to have permissioned joining. You need to be a permissioned participant. You can't, we need to know your identity. So enterprise blockchain frameworks enable that and still has this, and they still have the same trust and transparency issues, rather they solve those issues. Yeah, so certain examples of those frameworks, Quorum is a framework that JP Morgan Chase came up with, Fabric is by Linux Foundation, Corda by R3, these are all open source. So you can have a look at them. To join these blockchains, to join a Corda network, you need to be approved by an admin. To join a Quorum network, you need to be approved by an admin. So that's the difference. Corda is on Java platform, it's written in Java and Kotlin. Fabric is on Go and Java. Quorum is based on top of Ethereum, so it's Solidity and Viper. These are basically EVM languages in Quorum. So Quorum is basically an abstraction on top of Ethereum, but Corda is basically something completely different, and it's on JVM platform. So yeah, there are smart contracts in Quorum. There is something called as chain code in Fabric, and Corda has something called as flows and states, completely different. Yeah, so these are a vast area that we can explore, and we can go into each one of these, but these are good. If at all you're going to do development on blockchain, then these are good frameworks to have knowledge of.
Hello.
Yeah.
Like in terms of development perspective, like there are three platforms I can see. So which one is better for starting, like which is wide acceptance or like?
Well, I would say for starting, like we saw Ethereum, we should just start with Ethereum. I will demo something. I will demo writing smart contracts and compiling in Ethereum. So it's very, I don't know, everything started with Ethereum. So it's very simple to understand the concepts that they have come up with. Things get more and more complicated with these frameworks. So Ethereum is a good starting point. And if you know Ethereum, then Quorum is just the same. It's the same language, it's the same everything, just an abstraction on top of it. So I guess start from Ethereum, then check out Quorum, and then after that, maybe check out Corda.
Wide acceptance, like which is most market capturing in terms of?
That's where things become subjective. Because yeah, all the frameworks have very good acceptance. There are a lot of good projects on Fabric, and you know, Microsoft has made certain projects with Corda on their customer website. There you can see, we're gonna see also. So with my personal experience, I would say if you are into Java programming, if you like Java and everything, then go with Corda. If you want to learn something, a new programming language, something new, then go with Quorum. That's what I would say. But that's okay. Very subjective. Yeah. Don't quote me on that.
Yeah.
Well, here's one of the approach to privacy. So how do we maintain privacy in a public blockchain, right? So what Quorum does is just has one public blockchain database, right? Public ledger and a private ledger is separate. So in the private ledger, something can be shared with party A, B, and C, and that can be one state. So the green part, what you can see is one separate set of transactions. So those transactions are shared between participant 2, 1, and regulator, the green ones. Now the blue ones are shared between 1, 3, and regulator. Okay, so these are selectively shared amongst people. So there are 6 participants. So it's not necessary that I want to share everything with all of the 6. I want to share with 1 and 2, just those 2. So that's possible with Corda. We can have transactions private for just a particular set of people. Well, coming to a case study, this is one that involves marine insurance. So the marine transport company Maersk and R3, which are the creators of Corda. Of course, for cloud platform, Microsoft has hosted this, and Ernst & Young, they have provided the insurance part. So what is marine insurance? When ships go out in the sea, they are insured for the amount of that journey, right? For the period of that journey. So if anything happens during the period of that journey, the claims can be made, certain premiums have to be paid. Now, depending upon the route of the journey, depending upon the weather, depending upon which route you are taking, whether it's war prone or whether it's pirate prone, the premium changes depending upon that. And you know, weather can change anytime. So how do we know in real time, like what was the weather during this journey? So right now how things happen is the journey happens, and then after that claims are made, and after that reconciliation happens. So the insurance company will have to go back and verify all the claims, whether these things happened during the journey or not. And premiums are recalculated based on that. And it takes a lot of time. It's a very complicated process. But if there was a way to know in real time this telemetry data, then that would be great, right? Now, if the shipping company just puts telemetry sensors on the ship, and the sensors just transfer the data to a server, then which is in the authority of the shipping company, then how would the insurance company trusts the shipping company's sensors, right? So all of this will have to be on a shared network. So if you put a smart contract on the blockchain network, on an Ethereum blockchain, let's say, okay, then brokers' smart contracts will provide the insurance prospectus. So the smart contract will have written in it, okay, when we get the telemetry of the weather being and the temperature being this value, then the premium will be of this value. And when the conditions go to this, then the premiums will change to this. And at the end of the journey, all those premiums can be calculated and claims can be settled immediately because those sensors were sending the data directly to the smart contract. So there is no room for any middleman to come and change anything because those devices will have an address, this an account on Ethereum blockchain. Those devices, if some other device were to transfer some telemetry, then that would not be accepted. So I hope this example is very clear. Cool. So this is you can go to Microsoft's customer website, and you can just search for InsureWave, and you can see all the technical specifications, how they used Corda and everything to get this up and running. This is deployed upon Azure. You can go to Azure portal also and run a Corda node also, and Ethereum nodes too. So this is a live up and running blockchain use case in the enterprise world. It solves a big problem and saves a lot of time and money for both the shipping company and the insurance company and the broker. Q&A time, also some demo time. So if you have any questions, just let me know. I'll demo something. First of all, if you want to start development on the Ethereum blockchain, then I would suggest certain libraries. First of all, Web3. Web3 is basically made by Ethereum community to interact with the Ethereum blockchain. So it's a JavaScript API. Let's look it up. We are gonna use it also today. Another one is Truffle. Truffle is just an abstraction on top of Web3, which makes it easier to interact with the smart contract. So there is something called as Truffle boxes, and which are pre-made like sample projects that you can unbox on your system and you can get them up and running. One of those Truffle boxes we're going to look at is refrigerated transportation. But before that, we're going to look at Metacoin. So this is like we are implementing a coin on Ethereum. Now, there is already a coin on Ethereum, right? Everyone knows it's called Ether. And there's a coin on Bitcoin, it's called Bitcoin. So Ether is implemented very similarly, like we are implementing Metacoin over here. Okay, so first of all, look at the project structure. There is contracts, which has a bunch of .sol files. So these are Solidity smart contracts. There is migrations, two migrations. This is deploying the migrations contract. This is deploying Metacoin and all the other supporting contracts. Okay. Migrations will be used to deploy contracts on the blockchain. Tests have been written. Truffle will help us basically deploy these contracts to networks. So we have a network called development, which is on local host 7545. Now, where is this running? Like, I'll have to have an Ethereum node running on my on my local host, right? So not necessarily. We can have something called as. Okay. I have missed several questions, so let me first answer them. Hyperledger is framework of its own, so it's not based on top of any existing blockchain. They have created the Linux Foundation has created a smart contract based blockchain. So that's what Hyperledger is. Right now we are looking at Ethereum blockchain framework. So certain things will be similar. Like Hyperledger will also have smart contracts and deployments, and then interacting with the smart contracts and such. Sujit has asked, any blockchain based on Node.js? Well, Node.js is used to interact with the blockchains. Node.js is like it's a server-based framework, right? The server framework. So I don't know. I don't completely understand the question. So there are JavaScript-based blockchain frameworks. Yes, there are, but I don't know about any Node.js-based blockchain frameworks. Okay, where were we? 7. So an Ethereum node needs to be running and exposed on this port, right? So we have a development tool called Ganache. Okay, this is also provided by Ethereum. Sorry, this is also provided by Truffle. Sorry, Truffle has this tool called Ganache. It's a UI tool. It's also a CLI tool, but for this demo, I chose the UI tool because UI is always good, right? So you can see that it's exposed on 7545 and a lot of things here. First of all, this is just one node. It's a development node, it's not a full-fledged node. This is just one node with 10 accounts. Okay, this is the address. By default, it has already given 10 Ether as the balance. Okay, these are 10 addresses that I have on the single node. This is block zero, so Genesis block, which has no transactions in it. Okay, no transactions have happened yet. No contracts are here. Okay, these are the logs. So let's see. Let's link our project. Metacoin project. And restart this. Now, when we deploy our contracts, we'll see the contracts here. So, how do we deploy contracts first of all? So, first of all, we use Truffle itself. We go here. Shall we look at the code first? Okay. So, first of all, migrations is a contract that will just keep a record of what contracts have been migrated. So, this is just boilerplate. This is nothing that we'll be interacting with. So, this is like if you're familiar with .NET migrations, EF migrations. This is just keeping a record of what we have already migrated. So the contract that we have written is called Metacoin. Now, contract Metacoin, there is a variable called balances. There is an event called transfer. There is a constructor. And there are these three functions. Balances is a hash map of address to int. Okay, now it will contain all the balances. So even on Ethereum, there is a balances hash map or mapping which has all the balances of all the accounts. So this will basically have, if you put in your address, you'll get your balance. Okay, so in get balance method, you just see that we are returning the balances and we're putting in what address we want. Get balance in ether. So we are converting from V to ether. So V is a subdivision of ether. Like 10 raised to 18 V is one ether. So in this convert lib, so we have created another helper library. We are just multiplying the conversion rate upon and returning. So, all right. In the constructor, we are assigning a balance to whoever calls the constructor. We are just assigning a balance of 10,000 to that address. Okay. So whoever will deploy this contract, the address will come in tx.origin. So that will be our address. And so if we choose the first address to deploy this contract from, then that address will go in here and the balance of that address will be set to 10,000. Now we can choose any of these 10 addresses to do this from. Okay. Sendcoin is basically where we are transferring the coins from one party to another party. Now, this is where most of the logic is here. We have a receiver, we have an amount, this is a public function, this returns a boolean. Now, first we are checking whether the address who is sending the coin has sufficient balance or not. So the address of whoever calls this function is in message or sender. Now, if the balance is less than the amount, then we are returning false. If not, then we are decrementing the balance and incrementing the receiver's balance, and we are emitting an event called transfer. Now, this event is basically for maintaining logs in the Ethereum blockchain. So when we emit that event, later on we can query the logs of all transfer events. Cool, and then we're returning true. So let's see if Truffle was installed. Truffle was installed. Let's also look at this. So Truffle makes it very easy to just, so what is happening behind this is we have a compiled migrations contract, and it Truffle creates a transaction for us in which it says, okay, take this block, take this contract, and I'm gonna just deploy it, and I'm gonna sign it with my private key, and the private key will be of probably this address, because by default it just takes the first address. So this is the private key of this address. So this is the public key private key pair that we are talking about. This is not the public key. This is an encrypted version of the public key, and this is a shortened version of the private key. But basically, yeah, this is what is used to sign the transaction when we deploy here. Here also we do the same thing with the first default account. Okay, let's actually do it then. The path is not set of Truffle, so I'm gonna have to do this. First, I just do Truffle migrate network development. Now this network development is coming from here. It's compiling the contracts. I'm hoping there's a spelling mistake or something. Okay, it's not able to find, but we'll try once again. Again, but let's look at what has happened in compiling, right? So it's sol file. So when it compiles, it turns it into bytecode. All these contracts were compiled in the ABI or application binary interface is basically a JSON file that's stored here. So if you go into one, it basically has all the methods and the signature. So anyone who has the ABI, any node who has the ABI will be able to interact with the smart contract. And it also has the bytecode over here. The source path and everything. So basically, if you want to interact with a smart contract, you need the ABI. So that's what compilation did. Let's see if anyone has it out. Well, yeah. To begin learning blockchain, you can start from anywhere, but a good way to start is Ethereum, Solidity language, these libraries called Truffle and Web3 and Truffle Ganache. These are a good starting point. Yes. Let's try another thing. Truffle Develop also runs the same development account that Ganache runs. So here also you can see it's a CLI tool. We have 10 accounts. We have their corresponding private keys. This is an environment of its own. So if we write migrate here, they should definitely do it. Okay. So we were able to migrate the contracts. You can see for each migration that happened, it's basically a transaction. So the transaction has an hash. The transaction has a block number. So this is the first block. This is the third block. This is the fourth block. In between, there is also a transaction happening. So that's where the second block went. Anyways, total deployments 3. The cost of all these transactions were this much Ether. Now there is something called as transaction fees. So that's what this is. Okay. Now we can actually interact with this. So have over here, this is one of the ways to interact with the smart contract. You can write a Node.js API, you can write an API anywhere, and you can use Web3 or any client side library that interacts with Ethereum. But one of the ways is just in Truffle Develop. You can get the instance of the deployed contract. Wow. Cool. We got the instance. Now if this is the instance of the deployed contract, it has everything that we saw in the JSON. Now when we got the instance, we're going to interact with it. So another thing is we are taking all the accounts. So see, they are also using Web3. We got all the 10 accounts in ECC array. Now we're gonna, I so wish I could copy and paste. We're gonna use sendcoin function. We're gonna call the sendcoin function and the receiver will be the first account. Now we already have 10,000 balance, right? So we're gonna send 10 from the first account. So that's why we took it in all this, took all the accounts in this array. So let's quickly do that. Cool, transaction happened. So 10 points were transferred from account 0 to account 1. This is the receipt of that transaction. A lot of things to study from here. So the block number was 6, from 2, gas is the transaction fees that was used, the hash of the transaction, the hash of the block, and this is the signature. Yeah, ECDSA signature. Cool. Now all that's left is to see the balance, to look at the balance, and we can verify that actually the transaction happened or not. So let's look at. Cool, big number. Let's convert it to number. The balance of the first account was initially 10,000. Now it's 9,990. And the balance of the second account. Should be 10, right? Yeah. So this is one of the ways to interact with the smart contract. Normally you would write an API and an endpoint which you can call to get the balance and to call these functions and all. You can enforce like who can call which function. So right now anyone can send coin and you have the balance and it will be sent, but you can enforce whether you want some addresses to do certain things. So let's look at another example. So imagine you want to transport ice cream, okay? Now, and your requirement is that the ice cream, the temperature of the chamber which holds the ice cream must be below certain degrees. Now, how will you ensure this is similar to that shipping transport thing, right? Like, how will you know the telemetry of the chamber during the journey? So you have telemetry devices which will send telemetry to the smart contract, and you, the receiver of the goods, can look at the smart contract in real time and know like the logs of all the telemetry and know that, okay, no meddling happened because this is a smart contract and can't be meddled with. So in this project, there is a smart contract called refrigerated transportation in which it has statuses. So when it is created, that means, okay, it has been created, but the journey hasn't started. When it's in transit, the telemetry ingestion will happen. Okay, now if at any point the temperature goes below or above what we require it to be, then the status of the contract will be changed to out of compliance or void. And at the very same time, like, you don't have to pay for it or whatever your business logic is or whatever, however you implement the fines or anything. And if it's completed, then it's completed. So you don't even have to worry about reviewing the logs because the smart contract will automatically set the compliance to out of compliance. So let's have a look at this. This is a bigger smart contract, has a lot of business logic. It has two contracts in this. One is the base, which is like the abstract class, and this is the contract that is implementing the base. This abstract class has nothing but these events, but this is the main one. Okay. Now there are several parties involved. One is the owner, one is the initiating counterparty, the supply chain owner, the supply chain observer, the actual device that is transferring the telemetry also has an address on the smart contract. We have an enum of this type, and we have a sensor of this type, and we have variables for those. Cool. Compliance status can be true or false. And we have obviously minimum humidity, maximum humidity, temperature, and maximum temperature that we want. So in the constructor, we set all these values. So whenever the journey is, whenever the contract is created, we set all these values. Okay, the parties agree offline as to what humidity and what temperature they want, and they set all these values in the constructor. Now, after the journey starts, the ingest telemetry function starts to be used. It is called. Now, obviously, we have humidity, temperature, timestamp being ingested here. If the status is already completed, we don't need this, right? So we just revert the transaction. Revert here is kind of like throw. So if it's out of compliance, then we don't need it. If the device is not the sender, so whoever called this method is not the device, then we don't want it. Obviously, this is the business logic that we implement here. If the compliance status ends up being false, then the state is out of compliance and we raise this event. And for completing the journey, we check whether the supply chain owner has called this method or not. For transferring responsibility, there can be many counterparties in the supply chain. So a party can transfer the responsibility to new counterparty using this method. Yeah. You can find these samples in Truffle's website called Boxes. So you can find these Truffle boxes. There are a lot of samples. You can take any one of these box and unbox it and just start up and running and interacting with the contract. First compile, then migrate, and then interact with the contract. So this is a very good start for development on blockchain. Any questions are now welcome, and I'm just going through the chat to see if there are any questions. Cool. Nothing yet. Yeah.
So I have a question.
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yeah. So I am a cloud architect. I've been working on platforms with Azure and AWS. And to be honest, I am not really, really great with coding. Okay. Yeah. I've been a developer for 2-3 years, and I think that would be sufficing the requirements. And I joined the call 10-15 minutes back only. My point here is, what would be the starting resources? What would be the starting, the go-to point that you would suggest for the starting?
I would like to know, what do you like? What's your goal in this? Do you want to get very proficient with the coding part or some other part?
So, I mean, I haven't, I mean, planned anything to be, I mean, you know, a profound blockchain developer or something like that. My aim is just to explore an area. If I find it interesting, I would be, deep diving in it.
I would say, first of all, like, understanding the concept itself is a good start. So just instead of, like, you can read white papers, or instead of reading the white papers, which can be boring, you can just read the blogs and just look at websites that have a lot of articles about blockchain. And if you understand the concept, and if you find the concept interesting, then mm-hmm. you can move on to development. And you can, there are a lot of infra things that you can do also, because so deploying nodes on Azure, deploying nodes on AWS, and mm-hmm. have these nodes interacting with each other. So that's a valuable quality that it's like it's also needed. And deploying yeah. blockchain nodes on the cloud is also a good quality.
So
that
my,
is needed.
My goal here would be, I mean, my question to you would be, I am aware about the basic concepts, how the ink works, how the, I mean, ink or any money works, how the contracts are built, and what the basics, how a contract is set up and how it helps keep the transparency and other things. What would be a good start, any blog or any tutorial or any video you suggest to just move on a second level?
I would recommend, well, there are several, but I would Buterin's blog. So this is a good one. Vitalik Buterin is the creator of Ethereum, and just following him on Twitter and just reading his blog, and there are a lot of things that I would, and you would may probably not understand in his blog, but then taking that keyword and searching it somewhere and finding out about those keywords. So that's mm-hmm. a good starting point. So just, I think following personalities is important, and then articles and blogs come on later. So this is a good personality to follow.
Mm-hmm.
And
can you just paste this link in the chat?
Sure.
Yeah.
The router's graphics will be very simple, right?
Mm-hmm.
I will just share
that as well if you can. The router's graphic, the one you told right now.
Yeah.
So what will happen? I'll have a look at these things. I'll have a basic understanding. Even if I lead something else, I'll just ping you or if you're available.
Yeah. Yeah. The one that I sent just now, it's a good white paper. This is a good visual demonstration of what a blockchain is. Well, the Solidity docs for anyone who wants to get up and running with Solidity.
So one more question here. I mean, since you're going to docs and other things always, what are the services that Azure is providing? For...
That's a good one. We are on this tab. Azure Blockchain Workbench is one of the things that they are providing.
Mm-hmm.
And I was not able to get it up and running because certain limitations to my access.
Uh-huh.
But I really wish I could demo. So when you deploy Azure Blockchain Workbench on your portal, these are the resources mm-hmm. that will be created. And basically, you can just upload any smart contract, and it will just provide you an interface to interact with those smart contracts. So this doc, I think I have sent in.
Yeah.
Cool. The documentation of Azure Blockchain Workbench, if you follow, based on the knowledge of on Ethereum and Corda, you can. Get that up and running.
Okay, so basically I'll be needing to learn Ethereum for this as well before starting with Azure Workbench. That would be a prerequisite.
Yeah, because, well, there are some samples that you can just upload and even without knowing what it does, you can start interacting with it. So like when you will be able to, when you create the workbench, all you have to do is like what we have, the JSON here. Okay, mm-hmm. take any smart contracts JSON or ABI and upload it, and the rest of the work is done by the Azure Blockchain Workbench. So if you give it this JSON or any Hello World JSON
of a ready to build thing, right?
Yes,
it's kind of ready to building already built, but if we aren't, I want to modify, I'll need to learn Ethereum or something like that.
Yes.
Okay,
yeah,
I guess that would be it from my end. Thanks for your
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Well, anyone else? I have just dumped all the resources that I could find in the chat. So hopefully that will be useful to anyone. If there are no further questions, I think we can conclude this session. Hopefully this session was recorded, so anyone who joined late can go back and look at it. Cool. I don't think there's any questions. So thank you guys. Thank you everyone. And bye, and all the best with your new journey with the blockchain. Thank you.